立法會主席,
President of the Legislative Council. Let's continue with the debate on the motion of thanks. Mr. Yu Siwing.
Thank you, President. Housing problem and land supply problem have been troubling Hong Kong people. These are also the most important livelihood issues that the SAR government would like to resolve. Well, we have seen different proposals to increase land supply, but the opposition have raised opposition for the sake of opposition, and there has also been accusation of collusion. In 1998, there was the plan to develop Northeast NT, but because of the continuing political arguments and the difficulties faced by the government in seeking funding approval, the land resumption has not yet begun. And it was also proposed by the last term of government to make use of the fringe of country parks. And the opposition even asked some people to apply for the JR to stop the plan. Well, we need the development of brownfield site. We need will involve the resumption and the relocation of the relevant occupants, and therefore the process has been long, and the sites are not yet developed. Some have said that we should develop brownfield sites before we go for reclamation. This is easier said than done. Brownfield sites are scattered all over the Hong Kong, and not every site has the potential to develop, to be developed. And there is also no economy of scale in some cases. Resumption will be difficult. And there's also the need to provide a suitable compensation to the occupants and the owner. So the time will be process will be very time-consuming and challenging. This time, in the policy address, the CE proposes the land tower tomorrow vision. I think in terms of timing, in terms of planning, there are merits. Of course, it will involve a high cost, but don't forget the land so created would create a lot of opportunities and revenue. Certainly the revenue will outweigh the cost. We have many successful reclamation projects in the Central, Wan Chai, East Tsim Sha Tsui, Tung Chung, Chalap Kok Airport. The land there is all created through reclamation, and they play an important role in our in the maintenance of our status as a financial hub. The Singapore has created 22% of the present land through reclamation. Therefore, their nationals can enjoy the low-cost public housing. It has a lot to do with the successful reclamation that they have done. The government proposes to reclaim 1,000 hectares Chow Yi Chow, and so that in 2032 there will be housing for 700,000 to 1.1 million people. It's a pragmatic approach. As for the remaining 700 hectares, further studies will be conducted so that we can all have rational discussions, and also to carry out analysis through the objectively collected data. One should not jump to a conclusion. We need the support of the public if we are to promote our development. We should set our sight afar. Of course, we must offer our views, and the government should not be indecisive, and it should take concrete steps to launch this Land Tower Tomorrow Vision initiative. So I submit. Mr. Abraham Sack.
Mr. President, as a pro-establishment member of this council, I am duty-bound to to support the Chief Executive Policy Address and in general support to the administration in its governance in accordance to the Basic Law. Also, as a member of this council and a PAC member of 18 years standing, it is my duty to identify and report the failings of government in its multitude of service provisions under the principles of effective governance and that of money, value for money audits. With such introductions, I'd like to make my observation of the 2018 policy address, housing and land supply, as my colleague just delivered his speech, is undoubtedly the focal point of policy address of 2018. Let me state upfront that I support the plan to reclaim land for an East Island Metropolis, or ELM. The chief executive envisaged, and I quote, she said, "The construction of artificial islands in the central waters help meet the housing, economic, and employment needs in the long run," unquote. I will top up the mission statement. The artificial islands should not only meet our needs in the long run, but also our aspirations for a better quality of life. We should make the best out of the proposed 1,700 hectares of reclaimed land as cost-effective, eco-friendly, and technology-smart as conceivable. Improving planning standard should be adopted at the outset for the design of the East Lantau Metropolis in terms of home sizes, waste management, safeguards against extreme weather, and provision of community facilities in general. With this 1,700 hectares of reclaimed land, we are blessed with an opportunity of a lifetime, not only to design, but to actually build a sizable residential and commercial hub from the scratch. If we do it right, Mr. President, East Lantau Metropolis can emerge as an envy of the world. The government should encourage public input, especially from the multitude and multidisciplined professionals, not just from the consultants. However accessible, livable, and sustainable for the new frontier will be is only limited by our collective imagination. In a nutshell, Mr. President, Lantau tomorrow should and could become our Hong Kong SAR 2.0, an impossible dream makes possible. Exciting as it is, the Lantau vision is destined to take decades to materialize. What are we going to do with the present problems that we are facing? Meanwhile, the government should no longer sit on a considerable amount of readily available land resources. I am referring to the land lease modifications of agricultural and urban land. Attempts over the years to unleash the full potential of private sites by modifying existing land leases are, to put it mildly, frustrating. An application might have to be vetted by departments of lands, buildings, planning, transport, home affairs, environmental protection, and other bureaucracies. Each of these departments operates as an isolated administrative kingdom. Together, they form a virtual black hole of paperwork. The lease modification process is as cumbersome as it is punishing. As a result, we have failed to maximize a readily available source of available land resources, which were left to waste. also, Mr. President, that if we really look into the availability of land, there are plenty that we still can develop. But why they are not being developed very, very easily, the answer is there for us to see. Just for a development to take 5 years, it can be cut down to 3 years or 4 years. Just the very problem that we are suffering is a cancer to our development process, that of government bureaucracy. Government bureaucracy is at its best cumbersome, and as I earlier said, punishing. It is high time that we should review the situation. Attempts also regarding the modifying existing land leases. Over the years that I have been a member of this council, I have seen very little of such land processes. About 4% of this available land are being processed into 20 cases. As the voice of the real estate and construction sector in the chamber, I have been screaming for years to have the system of unleashing the available land to be simplified and streamlined. Unfortunately, my words have constantly fallen on deaf ears, a voice in the wilderness. In her maiden address, the chief executive last year sought to set up a policy innovation and coordination office, which reports directly to her. The office is now in business. It is meant to strengthen leadership by cutting red tape. The office has so far achieved little as far as the public can see. Correct me if I'm wrong. Last month, the chief executive pulled the same trick to create yet another coordination office, this time to help to realize the Land Town Tomorrow vision. She asserted, and I quote, "I will set up as soon as possible a dedicated coordination office, which is directly accountable to me, to steer the overall direction, as well as to coordinate and monitor the planning and implementation of the program. The office will be expanded as needed to ensure the policy and implementation can be effectively matched." End of quote. For your information, Mr. President, a dedicated unit was already established last December under the banner of Sustainable Land Town Office. When this council approved the funding for it, I was led to believe that the then set up was responsible for overseeing the planning and implementation of the Land Town project, redundant as it appears. But I don't hold any violent objection to erect another bureaucratic structure as far as the chief executive feels more reassured that way in the daunting task of developing Land Town. To follow the chief executive's logic, I recommended another coordination office to be assigned to reform the lease modification process procedures to reduce the bureaucracy. In any case, some sort of one-stop service should be put in place so that the applications can be dealt with without undue delay and readily more housing land to be created. In addition to the lease modification, I am in favor of the land sharing pilot scheme, formerly known as PPP, to expedite private landowners' effort to develop their sites. Only a meager 4%, as I said earlier, of the 1,000 hectares of agricultural land held by private developers in the new territories were allowed in 20 cases to be rezoned for private housing over the past 5 years. What a shame for all the wastages. The poor conversion rate is primarily due to, as I said, bureaucracy, inadequate infrastructure support, planning restriction, or local objections, and unrealistic high land premium. Under the proposed scheme, landowners' cost of infrastructure facilities will be deducted from the premium. If such facilities encroach onto private land, the authority may step in to resume the necessary areas in line with public interest. In return, at least 60% of the subsequent increased floor areas are to be designated for public housing, mainly in the form of subsidized sale flats. In any case, Mr. President, the idea for the government to facilitate private developments for greater common good is hardly original. The concept has been around for at least half a century. Let me show you some examples. Mei Fu San Chin is a shining example. The Estate 99 Tower Complex stood as the world's largest privately financed residential condominium project and was completed in 1978. Sha Tin 1 in Sha Tin is another, City 1 in Sha Tin is another example, given a conducive framework for leading developers were able to join forces in contrast with 52 blocks over 17 hectares of land in the 1980s. Policymakers do not need to reinvent the wheel every time. Sometimes all they have to do is to learn from the formula of success in the past. Administrative officers are very good in reading files. Do that. I hope the authority can soon hammer out the details so that people around in this council would not say that there is public-private collusion. What's that in collusion? When the rules of the game are set by government, when there are ordinances and bureaucracy to guide them, what we are here to is to ensure that the public benefit from wastage of land resources. My only reservation for this particular project is why the additional four areas for the public housing will have to be designated mostly for subsidized sales flats and not rental housing. This really reflects the inner thinking of our famous chief executive. In fact, 2 years in a row, the chief executive has stressed home ownership as a matter of priority. In her 2017 address, she said, as I like to quote her, she is my role model, "We will focus on home ownership to enable people to live happily in Hong Kong and call it their home. The government will strive to build a housing ladder to rekindle the hopes of families in different income brackets to become homeowners," end quote. In her 2018 speech, she repeated again, "We will focus the home ownership and strive to build a housing ladder to rekindle the hope of families in different income brackets to become homeowners." The English translation is indeed an understatement of the Chinese text. The Chinese version uses the phrase "yi ji,"
using home ownership as the focus.
Convey the chief executive inner thoughts to adopt home ownership as a guiding, prevailing, or dominating principle in her housing policy, or that of Chan Fan's minister. Mr. President, I would like to put it on the record, my objection to this misguided policy. May it be socialist, capitalist, or otherwise, no government on earth in its right mind take on the onus to enable families in different income brackets to become homeowners. The government focus should be confined to ensuring there is decent accommodation for every citizen to help those who are in need, not to help people to buy home and put them into a burden of and threat of bankruptcy when the market went down. I understand that housing has become a major source of social grievance. Many Hong Kongers, particularly the young, are upset, no doubt they are, if not furious, about runaway property prices. Why they are so? Because of the high government land price policy. The government focus on home ownership smacks of political expediency. It is so-called housing ladder might dangle as a political carrot. It might even help them to buy some votes. However, we must not confuse political expediency with public commitment. We must not equate populist demand with entitlement. Affordable, decent accommodation is an entitlement. Owning a flat is not. The chief executive must draw a line in there. The government should focus on the former, that's the rental housing, and not the latter. At the end of last June, Mr. Secretary, there were some 160,000 general applicants for the rental housing. The tally was on top of the 118,000 non-elderly one-person application under the Housing Authority quota and point system. I took that figures from our PAC reports. A general applicant has to wait for an average of 5.3 years, a shame from the target that we have set for years, 3.1 years. At the same time, it is estimated that 90,000 Hong Kongers are living in subdivided, substandard quarters of one sort or another. Public resources will be much better spent to provide subsidized rental units to the neediest, not to build more lokjigoi or bakgoi, whatever the poets like to call them. About 4.7% of our population, about 45% of our population are tenants of public rental housing and debts of subsidized units. I accept it is the government's responsibility to deliver bigger and better equipped rental flats for those who cannot afford to buy their flats. Empowering them to become homeowners is a completely different proposition. In any event, the government should contain housing and transportation expenses within a reasonable proportion of families' disposable income. Home ownership, however, should have no place as a focus in our housing policy. Rental housing is. The chief executive needs to rethink the issue, especially when there are early signs of downturn of property market. The economy is turning in the opposite direction. A blaze, let me give you some history. A blaze of Christmas Eve in 1953 jump-started the then colonial housing scheme. Except Block 41, all other original seven-story buildings in Sakit Mei resettlement estate were demolished. Sakit Mei, as you have also visited, Mr. Secretary, remains synonymous with the government commitment to house the needy. What needs to be rekindled is not the hopes for ownership. What needs to be rekindled is the administrative resolve to provide decent rental housing for those in need, 29,000 on the kill. A steady supply of public housing is, of course, permissible on a stable and ample land supply. And I am deeply disturbed by the way the administration has mismanaged the formulation of its land policy. Our political structure is meant to be executive-led, among other basic law prerogatives. The chief executive is to lead the SAR government and decides on government policies. 7 years ago, in her previous incarnation as Secretary for Development, Mrs. Carrie Lam launched a public engagement exercise on six proposed measures, including reclamation. Before that, the concept plan for land title was already formulated in 2004 and updated in 2007. After a round of consultation, the Sustainable Land Title Blueprint was published in June 2017. A key feature of the blueprint is to develop the Eastern Land Title Metropolis from the proposed artificial islands at the central waters, which conceived in 2011. Yet another study entitled Enhancing Land Supply strategy reclamation of Victoria Harbour and Rockhaven's development. Hong Kong has invested enough, I repeat the word, enough resources exploring options. It is time for us for decisive actions. Yet, instead of making a long overdue policy call, the chief executive set up a task force on land supply last September. A task force. The group is to forge further public deliberations. The group was given an impossible mission to come up with the greatest consensus on 18 land supply options. The task force then spent 5 months hosting town hall meetings and conducting territory-wide large-scale opinion surveys. They worked very hard. It was supposed to present its finding by the end of the year. Instead of building common grounds, the exercise has ended up polarizing our already divisive community, which was a creation of the last administration of blue and yellow. Over the past decade, concerned citizens have debated the pros and cons of the conceivable option of Nauseam. Current arguments about the envisioned Eastern Lantau metropolis are more emotive than rational. Forget about the emotions. Do some rational designs. The various camp positions are entrenched that they would hardly budge. The appointment of the task force is symptomatic of a government constantly looking over its shoulders, lacking the determination to govern. The massive open-ended consultation exercise was almost tantamount to a referendum. Our motherland would not have chosen this to do it. The government should, of course, take public opinions on board in making any major decision. Yet, executive-led government should never be dictated by populist sentiments. Now that a precedent has been set, it would be difficult for the chief executive and her team to justify why such similar task force could not be formed on other controversies, from curriculum to political reform, and more contentiously, the forthcoming local legislation, Mr. President, for national security under Article 23 of the Basic Law. Are we going to call a task force for that? By no means, you can't do it. The story took another even more bizarre turn when the chief executive demanded the task force to preempt itself to submit its preliminary observations to her. The move was apparently calculated to rationalize her belated announcement in policy address to commence immediately a study of phase reclamation on the near the Gaoyijiao and the Heilingjiao for the construction of the artificial islands with a total area of 17,000 hectares. The government should have explained why 17,000 and not the 1,000. Well, the explanation given to this council was, it's a secret. It's only the prerogative of the chief executive to announce in her policy address. Time has changed. Everybody was expecting, and nobody did debate so much as to the reclamation. But now they turn on why 17,000. In fact, it should be more than 17,000. It should be what Mr. Tong called 22,000 hectares, or Gordon Wu's 25,000 hectares. Mr. President, my time is taking a little bit more than I expected. No matter well-intentioned, policymakers can ill afford to remain non-communicative for a couple of months that they have been trying to build this 17,000 hectares. The ticket or leave it offer of this government, firstly, with the cross-harbor traffic, is a case in point. It was widely accepted that the tolls of the three tunnels should be adjusted to
reduce. 核心就係話可以點樣去改變個收費啦，而令更多駕駛者使用西隧啦，而依 Overcrowded.
New church residents' daily commute to go to workplace is barely bearable. There is an urgent need for additional routes for the 3 million or so commuters to travel south or north and then in reverse on a regular basis. This problem needs to be fixed, Mr. Secretary. This government has accorded priority to rail services over the modes of other public transport. The rail system is now saturated beyond rush hours. At the same time, transportation expenses have eaten significantly into one's disposable income. I am an independent board member of MTR, and I urge the government to make it loud and clear that the government must be vigilant in checking fare increase. The hogam system need to be reviewed because there's always no gam. I have listened carefully to the policy secretary's expanding on the policy address, and I dare say that I am not impressed. You have lacked compassion, nor have you lacked passion. Take a leaf from the chief executive book of how to service the public with humility and genuineness. In it is a particular case that got my heart wrenching to hear that the Secretary for Labor and Welfare to justify government inaction by insisting that money cannot solve the problem of elderly and care center. I beg to differ, Mr. President. I yell to differ. The bone of contention is how to provide proper care for the elderly to live in dignity. Over 36,000 senior citizens are queuing for care and attention home. They are expected to wait for an average 38 months before they are assigned a bed. The queue is getting longer as our population ages. It is a chronic issue that even news media have lost interest in reporting cases of senior citizens who died before they were admitted. The last time I checked, 5,800 retirees passed away in 2015 while waiting for subsidized rental care service. In defense, official has been harping on the same old themes. They assume that even more financial resources cannot bridge the shortages in labor and places of home for the aged. If you can't do it, import labor. Lastly, I'd like to talk about senior citizens and the special needs students. Like senior citizens, students with special needs call for special attention. Nature has deprived these children of mental and physical well-being. We should make it up by nurturing them. Each SEND student should be given an equal opportunity to learn in an environment that is best tailored to meet their specific needs. I have noticed that the government have given some money, but only to the subsidized and DSS school. Why not to the others, SEND student? This is again an issue of money can ease. I propose a voucher scheme in which allowances are given to these children so that they can pick the most suitable education providers according to their needs. They should learn from Chen Fan how to give more. Likewise, children from poor families and ethnic minorities must not be left behind. Their well-being must not be compromised because of a government's focus on home ownership. For those who are relatively better off, the government should be more caring to provide these people, especially the children, with a teaching Chinese as a secondary language. Before I finish, Mr. Chairman, I want to remind the Chief Executive not to be befuddled by the illusion of enhanced social harmony. The community is less confrontation as it was in the immediate aftermath of the occupation, Occupy Central. However, the relative peace is due to widespread sense of resignation rather than improved social satisfaction. It is not the government has done much to impress. It is because they are no longer bothered to be impressed. Many middle-class parents are quietly making exit plans for the children and themselves. Thank you.
柯創盛議員,
多謝, Mr. Wilson Orr. And on this segment, I would like to speak on transport and housing in the segment on behalf of DAB. Like I said, after the promulgation of the policy address, I went to the community to listen to the public views. And I found it's quite that the public has been quite concerned about the housing issue. Well, housing is the chief concern of this citizens coming to me. So this morning I was set a street booth in the community. Please, young people told me that you should tell the chief executive to address the housing issue. In the previous policy address, as you can see, the housing have been the chief focus, which the media and the public has concerned. In this PA, the CE has demonstrated determination, which is to respond to the public aspiration to develop more land to address the acute housing shortage. To be fair, how does having the poor land of higher housing costs while decreasing living standards. I don't see as much prospects here, but I'm confident that this is a long-term vision. Well, the following two sentences can sum up the public sentiment. Hope that they can able to afford their own home to buy one and able to afford the rent. And otherwise, the social discontent will stay unresolved. Then, first to talk about the role of government in the housing market. Well, it's in quite elaborate what exactly government role is. So, for those who cared about the housing policy, she stated that in the long-term housing strategy, which outlined the government's role, which were two, was to ensure that the market had a stable market supply to respond to demands. And second, if necessary, to come up with ways to stabilize the market so it won't get overheated. And in terms of land supply, I see this new Trump administration had grind its teeth ready for development secretary or the transport housing secretary have been identifying line for housing. So they managed to identify a lot of sites. Those are not satisfactory located. Many of them are rather infill sites. So they're expensive in cost and a small number of units and may destroy the community layout. However, there's no get around to it. But however, it's still better than resting on their hands. So they have to rethink whether they need to persist in going forward. So I wish also give my views on land territory more as well. And this June, the Carrie Lam had proposed with six property cooling measures, which one of them which ran to DAB demands, and also boosting the private housing supply and changing them into for switching them for public housing. Well, I'm not satisfied with the quantity, whether they can be further increased. Well, it marked a 10,000 land worth of 1,000 units for public housing. But can you think about the remaining 30,000 units worth of private land? Otherwise, it will be very hard to catch up on the target. And now we're facing the high property prices and high rental costs. Well, it's quite sounding alarm for Hong Kong. An organization have organized an property slave index. Well, I found the index quite frustrating. There's still a lot of grassroots families are not able to make their ends meet. Well, they can cut down on their food cost. Well, like even reserve for vegetarian. Or maybe they can walk on foot instead of taking public transport if the distance is short enough. But how about the accommodation issue? There's about 210,000 people living in undesirable housing environment and 280,000 people queuing for public housing. And for HOS of last year, we oversubscribed by 200,000. So how do and how the secretary is able to resolve the problem of the grassroots? The DAB have been tirelessly collecting the views, and why the grassroots found themselves in such deep water with such high rents? Why couldn't they consider relaunching tenancy control or rent allowances? Remember, Secretary Frank Chan told me that councillor and tenancy control have not been considered. I said we can take a step past picking it and take in phases. Let's say imposing tenancy control for those below 15,000. For rent allowances, frankly, for those who live in a matchbox flats, those subdivided units of only 100 square feet, they're actually not cheap. They cost about $8,000 a month. Well, can you offer rental allowances for those waiting for PRH 40 over 3 years so that they can catch a breath? Well, the DAB has been pressing on it for years, but nothing came out of it. Well, rather resort to extraordinary measures, I hope that you can consider it. Well, we are up to our neck and hope that you can let the grassroots to have some breathing room. That's why I bring it up again. And the chief executive often claimed that this would be the ownership led strategy. I think it's proper to construct a home ownership pathways. From my observation is that it's only have a framework. Well, this is hardly achievable. And rather for GSH and the HOS secondary market, and even the changing the pricing formula as well as the starter homes, we covered about the housing demands of 80% of the population. As you can see, for this GSH, King Chai Court is right in my constituency, and oversubscribed by 17.9 times. And the HOS secondary market, there are 2,500 quotas. They were oversubscribed by 13 times, and the latest phase of HOS was over 4,000 units, oversubscribed by 50 times. And even the starter homes had yet to be opened for application, well, it's just only 450 units. Well, by conservative estimate, they'll definitely be oversubscribed, but by how many fold? Let's see. And for these four schemes, will involve different parts of the ownership pathways. Well, it covers about 80% of the households. And together with PRH units, well, all together, well, I'm not good at math, but there's just only 8,230 units. And that's enough for the 80% of the population. There's not even 10,000 units available. If the CE is determined to deal with this home ownership pathways, well, I hope that they can achieve with the vision so they can afford to rent and afford to buy. That's the most critical, Secretary. I always offer the government a proposal and reject it by, and urge the government to consider relaunching the tenancy purchase scheme. Let's not talk about the price. Selling the PRH units had tried in the first term government, and it advocated for home ownership for all. And after the changing the CE, that the change of policy, which made the residents angry. Well, if you're home ownership led and you offer GSH and ask them to surrender their PRH units, and by the time to surrendering to refurbishment to release, they will take about a few months or so. And if you let the residents to purchase their own home, well, they wouldn't care too much about the price, but more concerned that whether they can help the government in the housing market. The CE had replied that due to a range of management issues have been declined. Well, this happened also to the private housing as well. Let's say you rent a private unit, you also came with problems with the landlords. Well, every time I get down to count is, I believe that my colleagues would agree as well. So I've been chased by a lot of the residents. Why the CE refused to consider it? Not only count is, but the whole population cares about it, and that's been raised by different political parties as well.
Well, you do a good, want to do a good job, but please do a comprehensive one.
I'd like to thank the Secretary for heeding our advice. Now the ratio between public and private housing is 70 to 30 instead of 60 to 40. But how can we achieve this ratio? Look at the supply. We need to think, we need to get to the problem. We need to introduce more methods. Whether we're talking about the HOS, green form, subsidized housing, the important objective is to encourage ownership. The Housing Society has been invited to run a pilot project so that subsidized housing can be leased out of without paying the premium first. Well, it's not easy to have the landlord and the tenant living under the same roof. So, Secretary, please find some way to resolve possible landlord-tenant conflict. I've been told by someone I know that perhaps you should allow them to lease the entire flat, or you can do this through an NGO as the principal tenant. There are a few advantages. If we have the NGO acting as an intermediary, then the support can be provided. If it's an elderly tenant, there may be young people there to provide assistance and support. So please consider this suggestion. Using NGOs as principal tenants in such an arrangement. And let me now take this opportunity to talk about the right to the accommodation. Well, to resolve housing problems, the first thing to do is to increase supply. Other members here agreed. Therefore, we need to look at the Lantau Tomorrow Vision in this light. I have consulted residents in the district. Well, we all agree that the bottleneck is land supply, and the government should explore different options. Reclamation was used to be the tool to create land. We look at the Shaoting, Chiang Kwan Lo, and other new towns. But you need to address their concerns about environment, about cost and environmental protection and conservation. The government should tell us how it would go about the Lantau Tomorrow Vision and how much it would cost us. There are divergent views. Well, that's a very common. Even my mother queried why I have not gone back home to have dinner more often. So please, be forthcoming in telling people the issues involved. The CE talks about that we need to move together, move ahead together. You have to do this. You have to be attentive to listening to public views. And let me now turn to another issue, which is a matter for Mr. Frank Chan. Well, the government announced a plan on East Kowloon line. People have been waiting so anxiously for this to happen. It's 2018. When can we get it? The Anderson site has been developed. The Kwun Tong station is so congested. Kwun Tong itself is so congested, both up
uphill and in the town center. Every time you listen to the traffic news, you see congestion here and there in Kwun Tong. And if you keep looking for this suggestion, this solution, and another solution, and don't make a decision, then you keep Kwun Tong residents would be very disappointed. I'm from a Kowloon East, so I want to talk about the plan to redirect traffic among the three cross harbor tunnels. I don't know whether other members will also be telling you this. You want to increase the tolls of each HC and CHT while reducing WHC tolls by $20.
If you live in Laguna City,
would you take a big detour to use the WHC so that he can save $20 in toll? This is a very partial way of thinking. People living in Kowloon East will still stick to each HC after criticizing you with some foul language, perhaps. I'm in agreement with the idea to the redistribute traffic. But would anyone living in Kwun Tong use the Western Harbour Crossing instead? And you know, and Secretary, you'd visited some district councils lately. You are very concerned about the congestion in the MTR stations. Well, MTR is now so congested. During non-peak hours, it's congested. Though during peak hours, people have to queue up in order to enter the station. I have to tell you this so that you can address the immediate and urgent concerns. Let me now turn to Mr. Wong. Remember, Kowloon East residents are not very happy about the monorail plan. You have the energizing East Kowloon office, and there were consultations. Consultations were conducted very slowly. Well, the idea was mooted when Mr. Cham Kam Lam, my predecessor, was a member here. He said there is going to be an elevated rail, and then you said it might be a gray. Well, don't give us a miss here. We want to improve people's livelihoods so that we live up to the theme of Section 4, Liveable City. But don't think that there's no one who cares to listen, and it's just all talk. Every citizen here expects to lead a satisfactory life. It's difficult to satisfy everyone, but if we can give them a proper living environment, it will be conducive to the development of our future. I believe this PA is successful in painting a picture for the future, so I would support the motion of thanks moved by Ms. Starry Lee. Thank you. Mr. Jeremy Tam, thank you, President. Mr. Wilson all has talked about the redistribution of traffic at the three cross harbor tunnels. So I will speak on this first by reversing the order in my speech. Of course, you are going to the
reduce the toll of WHC from $70 to $50, and then for Eastern Harbor Crossing and Cross Harbor Tunnel would all charge $40 by increasing the tolls. So taking the three tunnel tolls together is going to be more expensive. You want to reduce tolls for WHC to $50. And you cannot allow a big discrepancy between the different tolls so that people will not just go just use one of those. If you increase the toll of CHT by doubling it, I don't think the poor establishment camp will support it. Are there no other alternatives? Of course there are, if you provide a bigger subsidy. And the toll at WHC is 40 instead of 50, and there will be no need to increase tolls for the CHT and EHCs by so much, and you can still achieve your objective of evening out traffic. You want to increase tolls taken together, the increasing the tolls to reduce the demand on CHT and EHC. Come clean if that's what you want. If you don't want people to use the tunnel so much, well, you can increase the total tolls to $100 or $1,000. So on the face of it, you say you want to even out the traffic, but the hidden agenda is that you don't want people to use the Cross Harbor Tunnel or to drive so much. You provide a subsidy of $29 to taxi and $20 for private cars. What has happened? Are you encouraging people to use taxi instead of driving one's own car? Correct me if I'm wrong about the numbers. Is that on average there are 1.4 persons on in a private car, but 2.4 on a taxi. Well, but they are helping these people that crossing the harbor by offering the taxi to passengers. So it's just the same. It will be 1.4 on average. And for Eastern Harbor Crossing users, it's unfair to them. If this works out, if you use WHC, it's cheaper, but it's more congested. For those using CHT, the toll is doubled, but you would less time consuming. But for Eastern Harbor Crossing, well, the tolls will go up, but there will be no difference in the time taken. So the end result is that they will have to pay more without getting much benefit. At the Subcommittee on Railways, I propose an idea that is to have an animal compartment on our railway system. It's practiced elsewhere, like Taiwan. There are people who would need to take some animals to travel. As long as you put an animal, a cat, a dog, and a rabbit, for example, in a box measuring 43 by 32 by 31 cm, Can this be done in Hong Kong? And that is in the first compartment or the last compartment, either one would do. And during non-peak hours or weekend and holidays, we should run a pilot to allow this.
Earlier in the animal welfare subcommittee of the LegCo, I also raised a similar proposal and my motion was passed. But regrettably, the MTRC responded by saying that it's not feasible, they don't even want to do consultation. There's no reason why they wouldn't do that. And then I must also say something about parking spaces. All over Hong Kong, we are seeing a shortage of car parking spaces. And you want to provide an additional 1,500 car parking spaces in the next 5 years. They may be the government car parking spaces. Do you have a target? Say by a certain year, you would resort to administrative measures to cut down on the number of vehicles on roads. So you should do it like that. Overall, what will you do to cut down on the vehicular flow? What is your target and vision? Second, according to your vision then, what will be the car parking spaces to be provided? You must be clear about that. You should not just say that we would just fill the car parks to capacity and you would just adopt the Hong Kong planning standards and guidelines. You must have some vision. And also motorcycle parking spaces. The shortage is even more acute than that of private cars. For private cars, you can still say that car parks, private cars are definitely provided with parking spaces. May it be in Kwun Tong, Tsim Sha Tsui, Tin Shui Wai. So you said the ratio is over 1:1. But there is no such a ratio for motorcycle parking spaces. And we talk about roadside parking spaces for motorcycles and also for private car parks, which also provide motorcycle parking spaces. If we add all the numbers, the total will be fewer than the number of motorcycles registered in Hong Kong. In other words, you don't have enough parking spaces for motorcycles when there is illegal parking of motorbikes, and you said it's a serious problem. Well, even if I want to pay for parking spaces, there aren't enough parking spaces for motorbikes to accommodate all motorbikes in Hong Kong. So how will the government deal with this? Well, the land needed is relatively smaller in area. You can increase the number of roadside parking spaces. You said you already tried your best, but do you have some figures? If you don't have such figures, how can you ask the transport department to put in more efforts or to do more? You ask them to do their best. What do you mean by do your best? Would you tell would the wife said that, well, please give me as much as possible? You must have some figures. And then about share bicycle licensing system, I've been talking about this for a long time. This is not something unique in Hong Kong. You must have some regulation. The TD has come up with some codes of practice for rental of bikes. I've read through it. I think it's a toothless tiger here. And all it says is that people should abide by Hong Kong laws. That's not of no use. In Taipei, they have done something. They have come up with some regulations on shared bikes. There is a law setting out the say the validity period of the permits and so on, 3 years and etc. So if you don't have designated space for accommodating these shared bikes, then they will be taking up public space. And if you think that they use public space and do business, and there's no problem. So if that is gay, FHD, you should not be catching the hawkers in the future, because hawkers are doing the same, using public space to do business. And that same goes for shared bikes. And then let me turn to a newspaper article today. Mr. Frank Chow, I wonder whether you've read the newspaper today. That's about the XRL. The MTRC is giving away tickets to relatives of their staff members, and 17,000 people will benefit, and each will get two sets of tickets, and that means a total of 34,000 tickets. Well, in the relevant subcommittee of the commencement notice of XRL meeting of the electrical last week, I asked Mr. Frank Chen whether he knew about such favors being granted to MTR staff. Mr. Chen said that he has not heard of it, but then there was this newspaper report today. And last Friday, 10 days after which you said that you didn't know about this, such employees' benefits were granted. I can't believe that MTRC just spent 10 days to design, implement the program, and even issued a notice on that. Secretary, are you being kept in the dark about this, or you haven't read newspaper or what? Unfortunately, the undersecretary of THB supplemented by saying that if the MTRC could consider it, if they do have the capability, there's no problem of providing such employees' benefit. But let's not forget this XRL. We have to share the profits or the income with the mainland authority. So if you give away the tickets for free, maybe the MTRC will pay for it. Do they have to, I mean, share out the cost with the mainland authorities? There is a problem with either doing it or not. If you have to share the cost, that does it mean that your operating cost will rise? And does it mean that in terms of the calculation of the passenger number, etc.? Well, the KCRC has to pay the MTRC. Now, if tickets are being given away for free, does it mean that members of the public are actually paying for the 30,000 tickets given away to MTRC employees? If you say that many mainland authorities don't need to take that up together with the MTRC, then that's a problem. And if MTRC now today is giving away free tickets, mainland authorities will say that I will do the same. Maybe the there are 1 million staff members in the railway corporation on the mainland, and they are giving away free tickets, and the MTRC doesn't have to shoulder it then. I don't have any problem with such benefits being given away, but the authority must come clean on how the cost is being divided. Now, Civic Party has already said that we won't support this motion of thanks. Mr. Kenneth Leung.
Abraham Sheikh's speech on the property market, but after listening to my honorable friend's speech, I had to make a few comments. Mr. Sheikh seems to be asking the government to concentrate on subsidized rental housing market while leaving the subsidized home ownership scheme to the private sector. I beg to differ fundamentally from this philosophy, because I do think that as citizens, we have aspirations. We want to move up the social mobility ladder. And what's wrong if the government says in 20 years' time, every citizen in Hong Kong will have a decent owned at home? And this is the policy pursued by Margaret Thatcher in the 1980s. Now, of course, we have limited resources, and it's a matter of allocating how much we are going to do for the subsidized rental housing and how much we're going to do for various schemes under the home ownership scheme. And it is not the monopoly of the property developer to tackle the private property sector. And if the government provides a dire solution to a dire problem, so be it. I am a right-wing economist, and in terms of housing, in terms of property ownership, I think private property ownership gives people stability, security, and sense of belonging. And I do support the chief executive's initiative to promote subsidized home ownership scheme. And if it's squeezing the profits of the property developers, so be it.
主席,其實在今次宜居城市裏面呢, well, President, on the subject of livable city, I would like to say something about the environment and cultural policies. a city's environment has everything to do with a city's competitiveness, because overseas talents will be attracted to a livable city in this year's PA, there are a number of environmental protection initiatives. We'll be focusing on air quality, measures on waste disposal and climate change. I must compliment the EMB for proposing new initiatives in the PA. They said that they will study into banning the first registration of diesel vehicles in Hong Kong, and the together with the Pearl River Delta region and the Macau, they will study into including the VOC into the regulatory zone, and then they would also be studying into reducing emissions in the Pearl River Delta. Well, can the government give us some timetable as to the ban on diesel vehicles? Will that be done in 2020? And I also must stress that this, very often, the air quality of this city is related to regional cooperation, especially when we know that in 1989, the countries around the world have signed a Montreal Agreement to reduce VOC, and so that our ozone layer can be brought back to normal level. Last week, the UN Climate Organization issued a statement saying that after the international cooperation, the ozone layer has been sort of regaining its by 1.2% every year, and by a few years' time, the ozone layer will be brought back to the level in 1980. In terms of air quality, whether you are talking about the ships in Pearl River Delta or regional air quality, I hope that the government can step up and expedite cooperation with the Great Bay Area cities and the Pearl River Delta, and also upgrade our air quality indicators. We hope that in terms of our environmental protection work, we can take the lead in championing to provide a better quality of life within the region. Now, waste disposal policy. One of the most discussed item is the MSW charging, municipal solid waste charging. This is not an easy step to take, and I envisage that there will be difficulties in enforcing the law. But if we don't do it, I don't think we should drag on it. Taipei have spent quite some time, say in fact 10 years or 8 years before they get their citizens adapted to this MSW charging measure. Our topmost task is, apart from legislation, we should also do more publicity and public education. I mean, the government must work on it as a priority. If we can incorporate such elements in our civic education, then that would be good, because children would be taught to harbor such habits from a young age. So I hope that the government should also focus on public education in implementing MSW charging. The third point that I would like to say is related to energy and climate change. I know that the government has come up with a target to cut down on carbon intensity emission. But I noticed that for the IPCC, it has issued a warning recently. If we don't strengthen our efforts, it is difficult for us to reverse the trend of global warming. And we are also seeing the very grave consequences of global warming in terms of the frequent occurrence of tsunami, and the lower yield in crops, etc. And recently, we've seen the strength of Typhoon Mangkhut, and also Venice was subject to flooding recently. And that's all because of global warming.
Come on.
So looking at the measures they proposed in to reduce carbon intensity, well, the energy mix that will boost the percentage of natural gas, that's not enough. In the long run, we shall adopt the goal towards using full renewable energy. However, that probably cannot be achieved in the short time in for Hong Kong. The other measures, such as, for example, the floating photovoltaic cells on reservoirs can be expanded, or maybe in our footbridges and our slope that could covered with solar power facilities, or maybe secretary can consider it in the long run in terms of wind power or on our sea, or negotiate with the central government to lease waters for the mainland and together with our waters to set up a large-scale wind farm. Speaking of climate change, that will led me to the Lantau Tomorrow vision. From the green perspective, and Professor Yu Chung-Yim has remarked that in face of global warming and rising sea levels, to create a very secure man-made island, well, the height of height by 2100 will set at 10.3 meters, which and taking into account of the tidal movement and the storm surge and the rising sea level due to climate change. To make this island secure through year 2020, well, we need to protect it from sea level. We must boost the reclamation level at 13.9 meters. So for this aspect of the Lantau Tomorrow, I have strong reservations that whether it's feasible. And I have a technical query. So is there any man-made island around the world that allow you to build 100 blocks of 60-story buildings? Well, the man-made islands in Dubai are very small and only a few stories high. And now we're talking about hundreds of buildings that could go to 60 to 70 stories. Well, I hope that the secretary can explain. Besides having good environment, we also need her arts and culture and to allow our residents and foreigners to meet their culture needs. For the remaining 3 minutes, I probably switch to some lighter topics. And recently, I've seen quite a few quality local movies. The Film Development Fund recently got a $1 billion injection. And this movie, in terms of promotion and publicity, and especially in opening markets, they are in great need of professional assistance. And will this $1 billion injection enough? This year, we have quite a large-scale commercial movie, Project Gutenberg, and a smaller-scale production that have, so for example, or a Fatal Fire, or even a movie called Kidnapping. I hope that the policy address, after policy address, that we could all support the local film industry by buying tickets. Well, after the 90s, we focused our attention on China. However, we're too lopsided. Whether for our story selection and casting would be great restrictions. well, we have neglected our Southeast Asia. Back in the 70s or 90s, we have made of a huge market share. It's not that we're neglecting the mainland market. The Great Bay Area will promise great opportunities. Can we try to whether we have the Cantonese local production that can be exhibited in the 9 cities in the area, and as well increasing the number of film quotas. Besides injection, we also need a talent list for to train our on and off-camera talent. And small-scale production are indeed having it tough. Well, you invested millions of dollars. As a highbrow movie, they only get hundreds of thousands of dollars in the box office. I hope that the film development office can review their grant criteria. Rather, we bait on the box office performance or the artistic merits so that you can offer flexible assistance for those who aspire to enter the creative industries. And once again, in this policy address, I have a tough time deciding my vote. I spoke openly. Well, is this a lenta to more equate to the entire policy address? And for I would not disregard the criticism concerning the Lantau tomorrow. We're still thinking about it. Mr. Andrew Wan. Thank you, President. I will talk about the housing and livable city. While the focus of the policy address is on housing and land, that's what the government has stressed as the crux of all. Well, there's also an overriding issue. Mr. Kent Leung, would you like to say something since you stood up? Please sit down. Mr. Andrew Wan. Well, I'll be concise. Well, a lot of the Hong Kongers were asking me to hold up this placard. Well, it's not only greatly foolish. Well, if this Lantau tomorrow project go ahead, then there'll be a huge trouble in the future. Well, I see their point. Well, for the public criticism, it will focus on the Lantau tomorrow. The three point of contention: one is procedural fairness, and the costly projection, and the enormous investment was a lack of analysis. Well, after Typhoon Mangkhut, the impact of climate change is a public concern. I see the public has behaved rationally, and apparently this project is not winning the hearts of the public. Well, some may claim that over 50% support reclamation, but you have to confirm, are those who support reclamation will definitely support Lantau tomorrow? Well, from the recent reports and the opinion polls, and those supporting the Lantau tomorrow is definitely in a minority. So procedure-wise, what really vexes me is that you are taking the public hostage. Well, before the CE mentioned, they will hold a grand debate on land. So, well, these are the ace cards I'm holding. One is the failing golf course with majority support to resume it. Well, our own opinion poll shows that most of the respondents favor resuming the land, and mostly for housing and community facilities. And also brownfield sites and the agricultural land hoarded by the private developers, and hope they could develop in the NDA model, and also the new territories exempted houses rights, and the government use excuse of the lawsuit. Well, next month, when the new territories inhabitants housing right can go on trail, well, the whole Hong Kong public or maybe the whole test for land supply failed to be taken for a ride. So after 6 months, that's behind it. Well, Ms. Chase, hear about the exempted houses right and the family golf course, why didn't you use the land resumption ordinance and just apply it on the new development areas and just offer compensation? What do you mean affecting private ownership? Well, you can insisting that I can't give you answer to sue private consultation. Well, that's what it showed at the end. So then touch more is 700 hectares more than what the task force had displayed. Well, the CE backtracked somewhat and claimed the first phase were only 1,000 hectares. Another will be private public partnership. Well, they won't call it PPP. This changed the name. Well, maybe she thought that by calling the land sharing scheme, they probably the public wouldn't notice. Yeah, this debate has been so clear. A lot of the pro-establishment camp have been shielding the government and claimed the reclamation is a good idea. Well, the public does not rule out reclamation. Well, we feel that reclamation can be discussed. However, we could talk it on a case-by-case basis, depend on the justification. Last year, we have the Tung Chung East extension that have been passed with very little opposition. Well, I recently visited Yingchong Estate. Well, the residents did not react strongly. Some will actually look forward to the opportunities brought forth by reclamation. Maybe they can improve the transport network. Well, no schools and stuff without any new land for this. Well, land entitlement itself is a failure, and please don't blame it on reclamation or not. Well, not only this violate procedural fairness, and while this failed with a murky cost analysis, and we're also concerned about climate change. Well, some pro-establishment colleague defended, well, as that we're talking about a multi-pronged approach to security supply. Well, on the golf course, the NKH, and the fallow agricultural land, and using the new town approach to resume, that has been going on. And you said that, these are rather long-term measures, they need to meet immediate needs. Well, does it take very short time to reclaim? Well, the TV commercial says those living in SDU units would like a desk to do their homework. Stop deceiving the public. Sometime you said this, it will take a decade or so to resume the land. While this might be the truth, but nobody said this not be necessary. Well, are you really meeting our aspirations? So after conducting a bogus consultation, in this policy address have drew such criticism that it claims as a... Well, the day before, rather, the Mr. Chen Kwok, the director of the CE's office, and well, maybe by slip of tongue. The government not only look at the popular opinion, so we can't be carried by a populism. We need to lead the government and the public society forward. Well, there's still a lot of trump card with a pre-post stance, like in the golf course, and with Mr. Lau Kong Wah is present. And there are two consultation documents in parallel, this, especially when could have been contradictory. And a lot of the members are also members of the Exco and the Hong Kong Golf Club. While one-third of the Exco members have golf club memberships. Well, they're entitled to their views. My advice is that, well, they probably should keep quiet since you have a conflict of interest, especially the convener of the Exco, Mr. Bernard Chan. speak in public, it's foolish to resume the filing golf course. Well, soon the government is in chaos.
Time is limited, so I won't say anything more about the golf course. Let me spend some time on land sharing. The Democratic Party has repeatedly warned that there is the suspicion of government business collusion. Well, you may deceive yourself by changing the name of the scheme, but it doesn't fool anyone. The pro-establishment has also criticized this, that you are asking the Land Development Committee to be the goalkeeper, but the companies they come from would stand to benefits, so how can there not be conflict of interest? And as Mrs. Regina Yip put it, and I agree with her this time, that this is a stupid idea. The government has been developing new towns as new development areas to do it. That's okay. And I'm not the one advocating this in the loudest voice. But that's Mrs. Carrie Lam when she was the Secretary for Development. The government decided to resume land and abandon the PPP approach in developing NEST, mainly because the public would suspect collusion if we go for PPP. But this new approach would not infringe on private property rights, and cooperation with developers would incur political risk. I don't know why some years later she would do exactly the opposite. What prompted the change? Developers have been saying that we must do PPP because you're talking about private land. Well, we are paying compensation. It's not that we don't pay any compensation. Do they know the price they pay for buying the land? Well, the cheapest land would only fetch $1 to $2. And now they will be paid $1,000 or more. It's a 500 or 600 times of profit. How much do you want? I put this question to the to developers. Or do you want to make a fortune out of the land needed for public housing? And I have to remind these people that what you purchased was agricultural land. There was no reasonable expectation that the land would be turned into residential land. That's the viewpoint presented by a previous government official. And I don't know why so strangely they have changed their mind so drastically. I've still got some time. I will turn to another topic. That's housing. Some of the suggestions from the Democratic Party have been taken up by the CE. We talk about the need to segregate different market segments, and the government has done something about this. We also suggest that a 70-30 ratio of public to house to private housing. There's been some such discussion, but this is not the total solution. Mr. WU Chi-wai proposed allowing the HOS to be let without paying premium. But now it's partially adopted, and the letting is restricted to a room in the flat. And also that delinking the price of HOS and green form subsidized housing, well, it's good that this is being implemented. And a bigger discount will be given for HOS. Because if there's no, if it's not about speculation, then it will be more affordable by homeowners.
in 2026, very likely, will not be able to provide 20,000 PRH units. We may have to live with 10,000 or so. And before 2030, the supply will be even more restricted. So I don't know why you do not want to make use of the land in the golf course, which will be available shortly. And I, at this time, the policy address is silent on redevelopment of public housing estates. And this means that the potential of land cannot be realized. And let me talk about TPS. Well, you want to sell the subsidized housing units to people who don't want to buy, but you won't sell to willing the buyers when it comes to TPS. We cannot support the motion of thanks this time. Mr. Au Lok Him. Madam Deputy, in this session, I want to say something about my views on housing and land supply and my criticism of the policy address. Let me respond to some points made. I know that many people in the community are concerned about this, sale of public housing units, and the Democratic Party also support this. As a member representing a TPS state in my constituency, I have to say something about the management. When it comes to the supply of PRH, if we sell a particular block or particular house PRH estate, the supply of PRH would be reduced. Of course, the buyers would benefit from the rising prices. But can we resolve the problems faced by the TPS in the long run? We understand that the management problems are difficult to resolve, but that's the making of the government. Some of the premises will be managed by the TPS owners and some other by the LEUNG. Of course, such an arrangement makes things difficult. And how can you deal with repair maintenance? Or would you be doing something about an old water pipe, and then it turns out that it's not the responsibility of the estate owner? If you cannot resolve these difficulties, then I would say I have reservation about TPS. And when the TPS estate becomes very old and the repair fund has been depleted, would these owners be asked to take part in the OBB project? As a member representing a constituency with TPS estate, you have to give them a clear idea about the direction. Otherwise, people would be concerned. Maybe you should tell them that when the building reaches a certain age, it will be redeveloped. Or maybe you can deploy some revenues to help the owners. For example, you should allow the owners to manage the commercial parts of the estate as well, instead of allowing the LEUNG to be work in a monopoly. In Singapore, they have a more reasonable management model involving the owners. This morning, Mr. Wilson or Mr. Jeremy Tam have talked about the plan to redistribute traffic of the cross harbour tunnels, three cross harbour tunnels. I want to refer to the views of an academic. There's a Professor Hao Tou Guang of Hong Kong University who has been studying this for years. Don't think that I'm a friend of his. Maybe he doesn't like my comments. He may not like electrical members. You know that when an economist looks at congestion, they regard it as a waste. It's a waste of the capacity of the cross harbor tunnels. So as a matter of academic analysis, they would like to improve the efficiency with the WHC and at the same time reduce congestion of Cross Harbor Tunnel and Eastern Harbor Crossing. The government's current proposal can achieve this objective. And they said that the political parties wouldn't like it and would veto the plan. That's how I look at it. We cannot ignore public views or people from different parties and their views in deciding on what is to be done about public policy. If you think this is really nice, a nice plan, and then ultimately it's vetoed by us, the entire process is a waste of time. As Mr. Jeremy Tam has put it, well, actually, this is how I look at it. What are you trying to achieve? Are you going to implement a price discrimination arrangement? Or do you want to increase tolls generally? The government thinks that this is an acceptable plan, because you want to limit or put some the restriction or reduce traffic on Cross Harbor tunnels. But people think that this is an attempt to increase tolls in the guise of evening out traffic. And that's why they think it's unacceptable to reach a consensus with the community. You must do something about the perception that this is about increasing tolls. Well, even a price differentiation plan can involve no increase in tolls. But the government is saying that as a matter of reality, you cannot reduce tolls because you have to provide a subsidy of $1.8 billion to WHC. And that's how, after so much has been put in, you managed to get their consent. And I would also like to respond to Professor Hao, and I repeat, he may hate this very much. Wanzhai bypass has not been commissioned. Although we may be very ambitious about the effect of the bypass in alleviating traffic congestion, it's difficult to project the traffic model without the bypass. And people are saying that the government should consider buying back WHC. The government should change its mindset and think out of the box. In this session, we have touched on housing and the economy. So we must talk about East Lantau. Many the economists, Professor Wong Yi Chim and Professor Song Yan Wing. I don't know whether the government likes what they say, but my initial assessment is that they buy this very much. Otherwise, how come suddenly it's a 1,700 instead of 1,000 hectares? It's the idea from our Hong Kong Foundation. And they say that The CH Tong is the de facto mastermind. So all of a sudden, it's 1,700 hectares instead of 1,000 hectares. He said that it's okay to reclaim land of so much land.
No matter how much money we put into, we will be generating an income from land sale and we will reap other economic benefits. She will be able to get the return. I'm worried about such modeling because going by your logic, well, if I put it radically, then I would say you might as well reclaim all the sea in Hong Kong. Then you would also be generating an income. That sounds so wrong because we have a diminishing marginal return theory. When the land sale reaches a certain level, the return would diminish. So whether it's the academic's statement or whether it's the government's proposal, you haven't considered the diminishing marginal returns. In 2030 plus, you haven't come up with this proposal or estimate. Another thing which is outrageous, you talk about economics. You talk only about social benefits, but not social cost. We have a price to pay. Say, for example, when land is reclaimed, there are certain externalities. Senior secondary school students will know about this. We have externalities. So when you engage in an economic act, you have to consider other externalities as well. A professor said that if there is a maize field and then a railway or a train will pass by, and when the train passes by, the it will become an externality, maybe chasing away the birds, and the crop yield will be better. So that these are all the consequences of a certain act. It can be positive and negative. For Lantau Tomorrow Vision, we can see several negative consequences. First, what is the environmental cost? The other is social cost. How come that you are not taking them on board? You are focusing only on the returns and not the negative social costs to be borne. So you must give us more justifications. Then I would like to talk about XRL project, which is related to transport. The same thinking goes. We are seeing cost overruns, and you are adjusting downwards the passenger estimates. We can't trust your estimates anymore. And you also stress that there is the 2% IRR. We are seeing a cost overrun of 30%, and it costs over $80 billion. How can we have a return on investment? And for this so-called IRR, internal return rate, well, you are just talking about the time cost, the hours saved. But then you are spending so much more to save such time cost. The government is taking on board the social returns, but you are not mindful about the other negative consequences. For example, in Choi Yin Chun, there is a loss of water underground, and there is also the settlement issue or subsidence issue in Tokwa Wan. Acting Madam Deputy, it is your constituency. So had I win, tell you lose. I mean, that's the kind of logic. How can this PA be convincing then? No matter how we make the calculations, we would not be able to say that these white elephant projects are cost effective. From the public finance perspective, we do have a large fiscal reserve, that's true. Some people were talking about investment in a prudent manner. According to Keynes theory, ultimately the sum will be returned to the society. This is a kind of public finance philosophy that the government can consider. Just don't work on infrastructure. Many other uses can be put to the fiscal reserve. We have the great debate on land supply, and we talk about long-term supply. Well, we have to resolve the housing issue through increasing land supply. But this is a reclamation project which will be realized only 20 years later, and we have all sorts of queries on the estimates. You haven't come up with a clean account on, say, the use of the Fanling Golf Course and the brownfield sites. I think the 38 academics have made the wrong estimate. They are comparing the project with the sort of gray cat A farmland, and they have not considered farmland other than Cat A farmland. I have quoted much from their statement, but I think the secretary must consider how to respond to these. But going by the present figures, I don't think you have provided enough information and data to come up with such a strategy. So I speak. Mr. Eddie Ju. Thank you, Madam Deputy. I've heard many fellow members discussing the artificial island in eastern Lantau. I think they're like writing for an essay competition in a primary school, and the theme is the 10 reasons for supporting the artificial island in Lantau. And maybe I would like to respond to a few classmates' works. First is Mr. Ronick Chan. He said that he has several decades of syndicated loans experience, and he's tried to come up with calculations on the cost of the building the East Lantau and the land revenue. And after he's made calculation, he said that we can net a huge profit. He's not the first one to raise this, but there is a fundamental issue or problem with his calculations. And on the cost of the Lantau Tomorrow Revision, he is taking into account the reclamation and the infrastructure facilities on the 1,000 hectares, the reclamation for the artificial island and the infrastructure there. If you look at this plan, you will know clearly that this artificial island in East Lantau is in the middle of a water. And it will connect with, say, Hong Kong Island, and the infrastructure for this part will be major projects. Let's not forget that. Say if someone, a legislator from the banking sector, tells us that the cost should not include such roads and bridges, I think he has made a mistake. He might be referring to the reclamation in Tong Chong East. If that is the case, then it's like what Mr. Andrew Wan said. Not many people object to this, because if we calculate the cost of the reclamation and the building of the infrastructure, then the cost will be lower because it doesn't need any bridge linkages with other parts. So we can use Mr. Ronick Chan's formula then. And that is also the crux of the matter. When we talk about the East Lantau artificial island, we think it is fraught with problems. And if we object it, people will just accuse us of going against reclamation. I am against reclamation, but many other PEN Democrats are not against every reclamation project. We should distinguish this East Lantau reclamation project from other reclamation projects. The former is particularly problematic because it is reclamation in the middle of the sea, and the project will not be flexible in a way, and the cost will be much, much higher than nearshore reclamation. Another classmate used another perspective, Mr. Michael Tian. He said that anti-West residents are suffering. All along, when they commute to work, there is congestion. And as the population increases, we need another road network or a linkage to the urban areas. And then he said that the Lantau to Moravian, well, then we're able to meet with two expectations or fulfill two wishes. First, we have new land under that vision, and then there will be a new linkage, linking anti-West to the urban area. Mr. Michael Tian's remark is this. He would like to cite this as a reason to ask anti-West residents to support this project because they would like to go to the urban area. So it's like having a dessert. You can't just order the dessert. You should order the main dish to go together with the dessert. There are two problems to that kind of analogy. If you want to have a dessert, why don't you just order dessert? The government has been saying that a Route 11 will be built, leading from residents from anti-West to the urban area. That will be an extra bridge from the landing of the Lantau Bridge to Qingyi. And that's the dessert. And there is also the Tuen Mun Chek Lap Kok link, which is about to be commissioned. So if you want a dessert, just order the dessert. You don't have to order the main dish. And then what is more important is for legislators from the Anti region, we must think about whether we should support building a CBD near the town center or city center. If we go down that route, it means that anti residents are forced to commute for a long distance to go to work. Well, we have the opportunity now to break through that kind of model. They be pending the proposal on East Lantau. They said that the Hongshui Q project is a significant project. A bridgehead economy will be built, and there are all sorts of linkages. And this is where our new economic power will be built, and so on. If you implement that project and you put important institutions of the government in Hongshui Q, and maybe the third CBD can also be placed in anti-West, then anti-West residents do not have to commute over a long distance to work. And then we don't have to subscribe to Mr. Michael Tan's saying that we need to support this Lantau Tomorrow vision because we want another heavy rail to the urban area. Mr. Liang Chi-chang, the third classmate, he is thinking out of the box in a way. He said that the artificial island for Lantau Tomorrow vision will be like the Hong'an new area in Beijing in which a green city can be built. Whenever the mainland authorities talk about environmental protection, they always make staggering remarks. And they even said after the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge has been commissioned, not a single white Chinese white dolphin has died. Once every 3 to 4 weeks, we discovered a body of the CWD, and they even dared say that the bridge doesn't have any impact. This is the kind of logic that we are seeing in the mainland when they talk about environmental protection. Mr. Liang Chi-chang said that we should adopt that kind of thinking. I am scared. If we really want to do good to the environment, we want to build a green city, we do not have to work first on reclamation and then build a green city on that island. We can do it now. We don't have to wait. And then three other pro-establishment camp members who talked about Land Out Tomorrow vision, they are just seeing the tree for the forest. They want to promote the single or support the single project, and they keep saying, talking about the merits of this project, what can be done on this plot, what kind of benefits can it bring to the society. This logic goes against city planning logic.
Oh. Well, it's not like we can circle the area and ask everyone to support this project and consider the merits. Well, this is the biggest project since in Hong Kong history. Well, the four mega projects that already received a lot of complaints, and also the price tag, the total of the four combined and more. So we have to get away from the primary school and essay competition mode. We have to look at the full picture. What kind of vision do we have? How should we plan? We need to compare on the social and environmental costs as well as the construction costs. And you can't just say because it's profitable, then we should go forward. Even the primary school student wouldn't think that way. So if we want to leave the tunnel vision and look at full picture, the policy address illustrates a very severe problem. That is, our civil service ranks, I strongly doubt that are they responsible of governing Hong Kong, or are we allowing external forces, whether they're think tanks or the Beijing directly inform you of the final decision, that then provided the reverse engineered any justifications. And for all kind of urban developments, we simply cannot talk about single projects. Well, the development planning for the next few decades, they must have a few parameters. First will be the population projections. Or how about on the population demographic breakdown? And for the additional population, how much land do you need? And what type of land? Thirdly, then we enter the specifics of where shall we do it. Well, the civil service rank before 2018, I'll still trust him as functioning normally. Even though in a democratic government, at least it will be rational. Well, some criticize the government. Why bother carrying so many studies and hiring the consultants? Is that because they want to provide the justifications? So if you are providing something to meet a need, we have to know the, what kind of meet its needs. It was the full picture from building roads to building a reservoir on drainage. And as of this larger scale infrastructure, so we will provide the justifications layer by layer. And before the policy address, at least we get an idea, because we have this 2030 plus planning. And for 2030 plus, they will provide analysis on a layer by layer. And our 2030 relation will peak, there will be 8.22 million downwards, go downwards afterwards. Well, we need to discuss this further, since we have very much to do with the population policy and the one-way permit policy. But let's just assume that the Census Department projections of 2030 is correct. Well, the government had this figure in mind, and to cater with this additional population was at about 800,000 people, and after 2030 plus, the calculate of this additional land requirement of 4,800 hectares, and the government managed to secure 3,600 hectares of green belt and new development. So the shortfall is 1,200 hectares, and the 2030 plus is launched in 2030 plus. So that's why we have strategic growth areas. One of the East Lantau Metropolis. So back then it was projected as 1,000 hectares, and then there would be Northern Territories development. From the 2016-2030 plus report, at least we're talking, debating on based on the numbers. Do you really need that much population, the needs to arisen from the addition of population, and our debate on the project by project level on the merits. And now that our Hong Kong Foundation, I have to single them out, that's led by Pharmacy Yi Tong Chi-hua. For the past 2 years, have been incessantly attacking the government figures, especially on land requirement and on the size of the specific projects. So, however, they refuse to answer the questions on the 2043 population projection. So they don't have a population jump straight to the land requirement. So they come up, while the government claim is 4,800 hectares, and all of a sudden their figure is 9,000. While we heard the justifications, they want to live in bigger and better, they would need to build up the land reserve and so on. So they cite all these reasons but didn't touch on the population's projections. And thus, they claim that the tomorrow Lantau is not enough by its previous size, had to be increased to 2,200 hectares. So we now have a problem. In the policy address, Carrie Lam claimed that the Lantau tomorrow would require 1,700 hectares, which astounded the public and left the public totally baffled. Well, the conclusion from 1,000 to 1,700 hectares, well, this made the figures produced in the 2030 not justified. So, are you still following these 4,800 hectares of demand estate at 2030 plus? Are you still following the projection of 8.22 billion population? So, if you start shifting the goalposts on the individual project level, and while that will probably cast doubts on the findings of your studies, well, that will be consequential. Well, on the 2043, how much population do we have by then? Well, they gave the impression to the public that by inflating the projected land supply and expanding our capacity, and of course through the Greater Bay Area planning, maybe in 10 or 20 years' time, a lot of the Hong Kong people will get the residence permit in the Greater Bay Area, and there won't be much differentiation. Well, by what the population size of 2040 will become a trivial question. This deduction is not unfounded because you have departed from the traditions of the civil service of taking the procedural steps and justifications, and now you don't have justifications that we all can simply speculate and we suspect of having conspiracy. Now, a lot of the members of the public objected to this Lantau tomorrow reclamation, and someone associated with the real estate industry and claimed that the objectors are supporting the real estate industry because this Lantau tomorrow is to constrain their is televised. Now the government had a land reserve, or would no longer be afraid of the developers. That's ridiculous. The government is never afraid of the developers. And you also have the land resumption ordinance, and you also have your own NDA and other tools in the bag. Well, if you are objecting to the land out tomorrow, that means you're supporting the developers. Well, they're probably being fishy. This is, well, the government either colluding with the new territories and the developer in Beijing. So when it comes to land, you would just negotiate behind closed doors and would listen to the popular opinion. That's why, that's how this conspiracy theories would hatch. Well, when the Hong Kong public see themselves in deep water, but the government understand their plight and come up with solutions, it devote considerable effort. Having closed door deals with the powerful, while in claiming those object demand terminal tomorrow will be supporting the developers. Well, because all along they have sorted it out. Well, in the long run, they will use the man-made island to meet the political needs of Beijing or to suit the Greater Bay Area planning and turning in Hong Kong into a 10 million population city. But in the short run, they ask the local developers to play by the rules. That's why they will come up with this land sharing scheme. Have you ever consulted Hong Kong people on the scheme? We don't want any land sharing. We just want to resume the land and share it. Well, the government should be on our side. For those who've been hoarding land for a few decades and they just want to develop on their own, and now the government will want to share with them. We want to resume the land. Well, we want a methodical and systematic town planning. You first tell me the population projections, and you do the math, and then when we come to land options, we'll choose the options with the least social cost. That will be the approach of a responsible government. And Hong Kong people, or especially for the subdivided unit residents, that debate on the land supply, that they have been put under the spotlight as residents. And they claim that if you want a quality housing, they support the government. Support it what? One, that is the land out tomorrow. Well, when I press you for transitional housing, then you will simply refuse. Well, how serious the government is, it depends on how much resource you put in. For the ALM, the government would devote resources because they will make money out of it. Well, I'm asking you to provide tens of thousands of transitional housing, but you refuse. Is it because it's not profitable? Was that the basic health needs of the grassroots, while they had not much to do with developer, which they're not able to take a cut, so I won't do it. So that's to show you thinking. So you're taking advantage of the grassroots, and yet the finding that will be and taking them for a ride. We'll talk about the future of our society. We not only look into the housing needs, as important as it is, if the whole world is affected by climate change and the devastated the people's livelihood, well, what's the point of devoting your life savings to own your home? The United Nations IPCC, well, at the same time, the policy address, they come with a new report.
At the Paris summit, the objective set was that the temperature rise should be limited to 2 degrees, and 1.5 degrees would be the better goal. What's the difference between the 1.5 degree and 2 degrees? Or do we need to reset the goal to a limit of 1.5 degrees? And in a recent UN report, we are told that let's forget 2 degrees. The whole world, including Hong Kong, should move towards this target of not more than 1.5 degrees. It's already very difficult. It will mean many people will be displaced, those living near the waterfront. The land there will be inhospitable. So this is the UN objective for all governments. This is in a brief, plan in a brief issued to the world. I've told Mr. Wong Kam-sing this, but I'm disappointed that he thinks this is just an academic research. The UN has been looking into climate change for more than 20 years now. They've come up with this conclusion that the Environment Bureau's carbon emission reduction target is just not enough. It's a reduction of 20% of carbon emission in absolute terms. But the new UN target says we need to reduce emission by 50%. In Hong Kong, when it comes to the emission reduction, we are just talking about us using natural gas for power generation. And the government thinks that we have done the job by building the natural gas station or reception facility. Actually, we are now talking about a target of zero emission by 2030. And the government says the Council on Sustainable Development will conduct a bottom-up consultation to see what target should be set in 2020. Well, that's too bad. We need the strategy now. And you cannot be, you are not talking about, we are not talking about democracy. It's a life and death issue. We have the capabilities to do something. And the government now says those studies are academic. So are you saying that we should just sit on our hands and wait for the fate of our death to come to pass? Well, we are lagging behind by more than 10 years on all fronts. And all over the world, they are not just doing waste charging. They are introducing a tax on carbon. Canada has done this. And that is to say, whether you drive, whether you fry, there are costs in terms of carbon emission, and carbon emission affects everyone. So there's a cost, so there's the need to levy a tax. So the government should proceed to the idea of carbon tax. And STH
and the Secretary for Environment to work together. We are still seeing a 4.5% growth of the fleet of vehicles. We must be more determined to reduce the number of private cars, and we should be more determined into pedestrianize the core area in the urban districts. We are talking about changing people's behavior. We have to tackle the issues that are so important to us. We have to change the way the city works so that we have a chance that before 2030, we can reduce carbon emission by half. So that would give us a possibility to align ourselves with other places in the world. And then we can leave a world which is still livable to the next generation. Mr. Chan Kim-po, on many issues,